morning. It's good to be here. Thank you, Maggie. I never quite know when to walk up and when to do the turnaround. Welcome to the service this morning. We pray God's blessing upon you as you worship with us. Few announcements. First, as you can tell, Maggie and I sometimes just like to throw people for a loop. And we're going to do that today. So the special music, So the special music is going to be after the sermon. And then we're going to sing Precious Lord, Take My Hand after the prayers. And so you'll be able to sit down for that, because that sometimes gets to be a long expanse for standing. So that's just a little bulletin note. Speaking of worship, that's where we are. If you can sign up for worship help, we'd love that, because that the sign-up sheet is on the bulletin board, or you can sign up online. If you sign up on the bulletin board tomorrow, I can input you online. So that would be good. Annual meeting is coming up. Wow. And it really is a woo-hoo, because we are going to be burning the mortgage. That's pretty exciting. And to find out all the things that St. Paul's is doing, we hope that you'll be able to join us. And wait, there's more. We're going to have a picnic afterwards, and brats and hot dogs and watermelon and cookies and chips and things like that. And that will be right after we'll do the prayer right here, then send you out. And we, depending on the weather, you can sit outside or you can sit in the fellowship hall, because we have air conditioning. But if you think, oh, I'd like to go to the annual meeting, but I want to stay at home and drink coffee, you can do that too. And well, there is a Zoom component, and I'll send that out on Saturday, and that will be at 10 o'clock. We'll start the meeting at 10 o'clock. VBS, Tuesday night. And if you haven't had a chance to come to VBS yet, you gotta come, because it's fun, isn't it? Did you ever think you'd laugh so much? So Vacation Bible School, supper starts at 5:30. Chef Megan is going to be making walking tacos. Ooh. And then we'll have the service, but I know that Nancy and Marva are going to be teaching this week, and so like last week, it should be fun. National Night Out, August 6th. There's lots of stuff going on, and it's in your bulletin about gift baskets and the Sunday school materials. School materials. Yeah, it's one of those days. They're gathering school supplies. I've got to say, noisy offering last week, we raised $666.41, I think it was. 95 cents. See, it's good that it was not 666, right? So that money will be used to go and buy school supplies, which will go to the ELCA Outreach Center, to Jeffrey School, and to National Night Out. So thank you, thank you, thank you. That was amazing. Anything else? Then please stand as you are able for the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It's hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for the life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. And in Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Let us sing our opening hymn, Vagabonds.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God, powerful and compassionate, You shepherd your people faithfully, feeding and protecting us. Heal each of us and make us a whole people, that we may embody the justice and peace of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is from Genesis, the 37th chapter, beginning with the first verse. Meanwhile, Jacob had settled down where his father had lived, the land of Canaan. This is the story of Jacob. The story continues with Joseph, 17 years old at the time, helping out his brothers in herding the flocks. These were his half-brothers, actually, the sons of his father's wives, Bilhah and Zilpha. And Joseph brought his father bad reports on them. Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons because he was the child of his old age, and he made him an elaborately embroidered coat. When his brothers realized that their father loved him more than them, they grew to hate them. They wouldn't even speak to him. Joseph had a dream. When he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said, "Listen to this dream I had. We were all out in the field gathering bundles of wheat. All of a sudden, my bundle stood straight up, and your bundles circled around it and bowed down to mine." His brother said, "So, you're going to rule us? You're going to boss us around?" And they hated him more than ever because of his dreams and the way he talked. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel. Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter, beginning with the 35th verse.
Glory to you, O Lord.
James and John, Zebedee's sons, came up to him. "Teacher, we have something we want you to do for us." "What is it?" "I'll see what I can do." "Arrange it," they said, "so that we will be awarded the highest places of honor in your glory, one of us at your right and the other at your left." Jesus said, "You have no idea what you're asking. Are you capable of drinking the cup I drink, of being baptized in the baptism I'm about to be plunged into?" "Sure," they said. "Why not?" Jesus said, "Come to think of it, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized in my baptism. But as to awarding places of honor, that's not my business. There are other arrangements for that." This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated.
Okay, once again, it's time for the children's message. And Karen has it this week. Okay. What do you think it is, Levi? What do you think? I don't know either. That's what kind of scares me. Okay. There is something in there. Oh. It's a cardinal. I should put it like this so you can see. No. It's a cardinal. And there is a tradition with the cardinals that when you see a cardinal, that it's somebody who you love has passed on, coming back for a visit. And I love cardinals for that reason, because it makes me remember and think, oh, is that my mom who's coming back for a visit? My dad? I remember a few years ago, and there was a young mother who passed away, and leaving a husband and little kids. And after the funeral, they came back to the house. And the husband looked out and he said, there wasn't just one cardinal, but the whole backyard was filled with cardinals. And that brought him such great comfort because he thought, I'm not alone and she's with me. And I think that's what I get from cardinals when I see a cardinal, that we are not alone, that God gives us such gifts and those little glimpses into heaven that we are not alone. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, thank you. Thank you because you know when we are grieving. You know when we are feeling so alone, that you send a sign. Help us, Lord, to open our eyes to recognize that sign that we are not alone, that you are with us as well as our loved ones. So surround us, uphold us, and keep us in your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Karen. Thank you. That's perfect. Now, I know Sandy and Lori. Sandy, you get it next?
Yeah, Lori.
They get to fight over it. And I'm kind of thinking that we might just do this round all year round, okay? So everybody gets a chance. Let us pray. Prepare our hearts, Lord, to receive your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, so that by hearing we may believe, and by believing we may obey your will. Reveal to us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Gary Richman told the story about how he went to the zoo and he just happened to be there at the zoo when a mama giraffe was about to give birth to her baby. And he said, you could see some of the hooves coming out and the head. And he was standing right next to the zookeeper named Jack. And he said to Jack, Isn't anybody gonna be in there to catch her? You know, to catch that baby, that's like a 10-foot drop. And Jack said, oh, yeah, you go right ahead. Just remember that mama can kick her hind legs and take your head off. He said, okay, yeah. So they watched this miracle of birth of this huge giraffe and plop. Out came the baby on its back, and the mother kind of, you know, smelled it. And then the baby was just kind of laying there. Mother gave it a big kick. And so the baby starts moving around and tries to get up on those long spindly legs, and all of a sudden just fell right back down. Mother kicked it again, kind of sent it tumbling. So the baby tried again to kind of get up and finally got up and was kind of, you know, just standing there getting its bearings. You know what that mother did? Kicked the legs out from under it. And he looked at the zookeeper and he said, why on earth did she do that? And he said, because she wanted the baby to know how to remember to get up. Because when you're out in the wild and the herd has to get going in because of predators, you need to get up in a hurry. Have you ever felt like you've been kicked when you're down? Had your feet knocked out from under you? I think Joseph did. I think Joseph must have felt a lot like that baby giraffe, who its mother was kicking it, you know, and Joseph was being kicked by the people he was a part of, his family, who loved him, or thought they did. So, we pick up the story again today with Joseph, the favorite son of Jacob, who last week wrestled with God. God said, okay, your name is not going to be Jacob anymore. It's going to be Israel. So here we have the 12 sons, the 12 tribes of Israel. So now we've got Joseph, the favorite son. I tried to convince John to come and stand up here, and he said, oh, that might be a little awkward. But that's okay. So Joseph's the favorite son. And you know, if you've watched Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, whether it be with Donny Osmond, whether it be with any of the various groups that have put this on, the Tedding's granddaughter was just the narrator this spring, summer for it. It's a great story. Bonnie Knadler said she hadn't watched it and then watched it last night on YouTube. YouTube. So watch it because it's so good and it helps to get the story straight. So we've got Joseph, the favorite son. And what does he do? His father makes him a coat. Now, it all depends on what you translate the Hebrew from. Whether, I don't think they translated an Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, but I think Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice did. But it could also be a coat of many colors. It could be a wool coat. It could be a white ornate coat. It could be a striped coat. But the coat, and actually there was one other place in the Bible where the coat is mentioned. And it's by Tamar, who was a princess, wore a coat like that. So, you know, you never know what it is. But all those brothers knew was that Dad didn't go out and buy the coat. Dad made the coat for him. Now, that in and itself is really pretty interesting because you think, oh, did Israel know how to make a garment? Who taught him? Did he learn from his mom? Did he learn from his wives? The fact that he spent time making the coat, and then what was it made out of? Now, Dolly Parton sang her song, The Coat of Many Colors, and it's a great song, but she talked about how her mother got a bag of rags, and they had nothing, and how Dolly Parton's mom went and sewed this coat, and as she sewed this coat, she told Dolly about the coat of many colors that Joseph wore, and when Dolly wore it, she was so thrilled because her mother made this with love. And she wore it to school and the kids ridiculed her. And she thought, I don't get it. My mother made this coat out of love. And I think Jacob or Israel made this coat out of love. But he also made it in a very certain way. Now, I know that I'm not very tall. Surprise. But if Dave Mielke was up here, it would come down at least between his ankles and his knees. So it's a long, long coat, long arms, And that's important, because if you're herding sheep like Joseph's 10 brothers, you're herding sheep for your dad. You don't want to be wearing something that's long so you can scramble up the rocks and go after these sheep. You want something short sleeved, something short that you can just go and run and not get, you know, try and run up stuff. So when they saw this coat that their brother wore, that dad made, remember Smothers Brothers? Mom always liked you best. Dad always liked you best. And it's true. So automatically, poor Joseph is set up. But Joseph doesn't help himself. So God gives him dreams. Now, I don't know if you ever interpret your own dreams. Some of my dreams, I think, whoa. I used to sleepwalk and dream that people were over, and they've gone to bed, and I haven't brought them towels or anything, and I'd walk around in my house looking for that. Okay, that was in another life. But these dreams that Joseph had, he's 17 years old, he's the punk kid, and probably out of innocence, I like to think it was innocence, Joseph said to his brothers, hey, you want to hear the dream that I had? I dreamt that we were out in the fields and we were making sheaves of wheat, and all of a sudden my sheaf stood up and yours all bowed down to me. You know, if I told that to my brothers, they'd be mad. And those brothers were mad. You punk kid, we're gonna bow down to you, this 17-year-old kid who is wearing daddy's coat that made. But then it gets worse. Well, do you want to hear my other dream? I dreamt that the sun and the moon and the stars all bowed down to me. And even his dad rebuked him. Now, they use the word rebuke like how Jesus rebuked the wind and the waves and they stopped. His dad rebuked him. What are you talking about? We're gonna bow down to you. But God had dreams and gave Joseph dreams. And I think Joseph, I like how Donny Osmond is Joseph, because he's just innocent and just naive and not realizing all these people who are like plotting against him. So one day his dad says, okay, you know, we've got fields and they've got the flocks over in the fields and I haven't heard from your brothers for a while. Can you go check on them? So Joseph puts on his coat and he starts walking out there. And they see him, and they said, there's that dreamer. There's that dreamer, let's get him. Now, Reuben, who had his own troubles, but Reuben was the oldest one, and he said, let's not kill him. Let's put him in a pit. Excuse me, because he thought, all right, I'll come back later and rescue him and take him back to dad. But the brothers are like, yeah, yeah, let's put him in the pit. So they put him in a pit. And then Reuben must have gone off someplace, and all of a sudden some Ishmaelites or Midianites, travelers came by, and they thought, ooh, we could make some money. So, hey, do you want to buy this guy? Yeah, he can be a slave. And the Midianites thought, okay. So they bought him, gave them the money, and off Joseph went as a slave. And they took him to Potiphar, who bought him in Egypt. And Potiphar was the king of the guards, captain of the guards. But that's next week's See, you have to come back next week. But I think about the dreams. Joseph, the dreamer. I closed my eyes, threw back the curtain to see for certain what I thought I knew. But far in the east, someone was weeping, but the world was sleeping. Any dream will do. But is it any dream? Or is it God's dream? And what is God's dream for you? What is God's dream for you to live in this world? What is God's dream for this world? I think about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who said, "I have a dream that one day we will all be together. And it doesn't matter what we look like, what we sound like, what we act like, what we believe, but we'll all be together." And I have to believe that is the dream that God wants for each one of us. To look past our own prejudices, to look past our own troubles, to see the needs of others. And the thing is, in spite of all that happens to Joseph, God is with him. God is with him, and he didn't lose sight of that. So any dream will do. God's dream for you. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
I closed my eyes, drew back the curtain to see for certain what I thought I knew. Far, far away, someone was weeping, but the world was sleeping. Any dream will do. I wore my coat with golden lining, bright colors shining, wonderful and new. And in the east, the dawn was breaking, and the world was waking. Any dream will do. A crash of drums, a flash of light, my golden coat flew out of sight. The feathers faded into darkness. I was left alone. May I return will.
Please stand as you are able as we continue with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Be with us, Lord, as we move through each day. Take away any jealousy or anxiety about others. Help us to see the good in one another and to act in your love. Lord, in your mercy. From before the foundation of the world, you are God. Revive ecosystems destroyed by human greed. Curb our desire to put wealth ahead of the health of all who call this planet home. Lord, in your mercy. God of all, we pray for this nation and our leaders. We pray that we continue our course of freedom for all. Raise up all who are victims of marginalization, discrimination, and hate. Banish white supremacy and bigotry from the hearts of your people, and remove the inclination toward anger and violence. Lord, in your mercy. God of justice, you reign in steadfast love. Bring peace between nations ravaged by war or strife, especially in Gaza, Israel, and Ukraine, and illumine paths of justice and freedom for those who lead them. Lord, in your mercy. God of compassion, your touch brings healing, and your word revives us for life. Hear our prayers for Pam, Bev, Sue, George, Joan, Karen, David, Kathy, Patty, Greg, Barbara, Judy, Bob, Kathy, Jess, Marion, Jim, Vernus, Julie, Gigi, Antonio, Shelley, Jay, Amelia, Kevin, Don, Laurie, Paul and Mary Ellen, Ruth, Diana, Sherry, Dan, Laura, Ed, John, Ted, and those we name before you either out loud or in the silence of our hearts. Turn wailing into dancing and weeping into joy. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O God, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in Jesus Christ, the spring of new and everlasting life. Amen. You may be seated. We continue with the singing of Precious Lord. Thank you.
you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection has opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels and the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we are reminded that Christ is present, who calls to us, gathers us, loves us, and sends us out to love and care for one another. Let us join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated as we continue with the singing of Lamb of God. For those who are receiving communion in the pews or at home, the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Please stand as you are able. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us with this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen.
The blessing of God, who provides for us, who feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Let us sing our final hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory.
In peace, you are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God.